Prepare our hearts, O Lord, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, so that hearing we may also obey your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. If you have a Bible or want to use your pew Bible to keep up, our scripture this morning, it'll be available on the screen, is from Mark chapter 8, and I'll be reading verses 1 through 21. Mark writes, "In those days, when again a great crowd had gathered, and they had nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples to him and said to them, 'I have compassion on the crowd, because they have been with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. And if I send them away hungry to their homes, they will faint on the way, and some of them have come from far away.' And his disciple answered him, 'How can one feed these people with bread here in this desolate place?' And he asked them, 'How many loaves do you have?' They said, 7. And he directed the crowd to sit down on the ground. And he took the 7 loaves, and having given thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples to set before the people. And they set them before the crowd. And they had a few small fish, and having blessed them, he said that these also should be set before them. And they ate and were satisfied. And they took up the broken pieces left over, 7 baskets full. And there were about 4,000 people. And he sent them away. And immediately he got into the boat with his disciples and went to the district of Dalmanutha. The Pharisees came and began to argue with him, seeking from him a sign from heaven to test him. And he sighed deeply in his spirit and said, 'Why does this generation seek a sign? Truly I say to you, no sign will be given to this generation.' And he left them, got into the boat, and went to the other side. Now they had forgotten to bring bread, and they had only 1 loaf with them in the boat. And he cautioned them, saying, 'Watch out, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the leaven of Herod.' And they began discussing with one another the fact that they had no bread. And Jesus, aware of this, said to them, 'Why are you discussing the fact that you have no bread? Do you not yet perceive or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Having eyes, do you not see? And having ears, do you not hear? And do you not remember when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many baskets full of broken pieces did you take up?' They said to him, 12. And the 7 for the 4,000, how many baskets full of broken pieces did you take up? And they said to him, 7. And he said to them, 'Do you not yet understand?'" This is the word of the Lord. Friday morning, I drove to Asheville to meet a couple of friends of mine from a small group in seminary for lunch. Justin lives in Shelby, and Carly is a children's minister in Greenville. So we ate at the cantina at Biltmore Village. I scratched my Tex-Mex itch, had carnitas tacos. They were good. I like good food. Novel concept, I know. I really like great food, fantastic food. There's this restaurant in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, called Coconuts. Sarah and I ate there once during our honeymoon, and a second time recently when we went to Florida for our baby moon. That seafood, which is Coconuts' specialty, is worth the cost of the trip, as far as I'm concerned. The first time Sarah and I ate there, we had an appetizer called Scoobies. It's like a $20 appetizer. Everything else is in that like 9 to 10 range, and then they've got one. It's the appetizer to end all appetizers. But they had to go and give it a name called Scoobies, and I have no idea why. Scoobies are snow crab claws served in a dish of spiced butter with bread on the side. And that meat melts like cotton candy on the tongue. And then that bread is the perfect tool for sopping up the rest of that butter. It is not a very calorie-friendly appetizer. But then for my entree that night, I had swordfish. I didn't even know you could eat swordfish. And I got to eat it fresh caught, seasoned to perfection, and textured, you know, I'm kind of used to like frozen grocery store tilapia. This thing cut like a steak. Like a steak. You've never seen a knife cut through meat with such ease. So the whole meal was delicious. It's unforgettable. Really, that was years ago, almost 3 years ago. It'll have been, well, no, because we didn't go on our honeymoon on our anniversary. That's not how that works. But shameless plug, our anniversary is this week. I'm sure many of you have memories of such meals. They may not be the same meal. They may not be Scoobies and swordfish. But they do have something in common, I think. You can probably count the times you've had meals like that on one hand. For some of you, they don't even make up a hand. It's just one finger. Because those meals don't even make up a fraction of the meals that have nourished you and nourished me our whole lives. Not a fraction. Anglican pastor and author Tish Harrison Warren writes in her excellent book, it won Christianity Today's Book of the Year, Liturgy of the Ordinary, quote, "Most of the meals I've eaten, thousands upon thousands, were utterly unremarkable. If you asked me what I ate for lunch 3 weeks ago on Monday, I could not tell you. And yet that average, forgettable meal nourished me. Thousands of forgotten meals brought me to today," end quote. What has nourished me more? The bottomless pit of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches that I've eaten over the course of my life? Or the unforgettable swordfish that I have had once in 27 years? Mark records a few unforgettable moments in the Gospel of Mark, his Gospel. In Mark 1, Jesus heals a man in Capernaum with an unclean spirit, a demon. And Mark writes that the people who saw this were all amazed. In Mark chapter 2, Jesus, again in Capernaum, heals a paralytic, telling him to rise, pick up your bed, and go home. The man rose, did just as Jesus did, and Mark writes that the crowd was amazed and glorified God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." These moments were not just reserved for bystanders. The disciples experienced their fair share. They were in a boat sailing ahead of Jesus to Bethsaida. It was storming. The wind was hard-pressed against them, Mark writes. And at about 4 a.m., Jesus, who'd stayed back to pray a while, came to them, not on a boat, but walking on the sea. And Mark writes that the disciples all saw him and were terrified. These are just three of several instances in the Gospel of Mark where Jesus performs a miracle that generates a rush of excitement and amazement, even terror, pure horror at the sight of a man walking on a stormy sea. Unmistakable acts of divine goodness and power that left everyone with their jaws needing to be picked up off the floor. But not this time. Not this time. Jesus takes 7 loaves, gives thanks, breaks them, and gives them to the disciples to feed 4,000 people. And all Mark writes is that they all ate and were satisfied. No amazement, no astonishment, no wonder. No one even cares to know how Jesus did it, apparently. No one asks. They just ate it and then went on their way. They went home. Do they even know what they've witnessed? What they've experienced? I mean, even if we decide to give the crowd the benefit of the doubts, how did the disciples not notice? The disciples of Jesus, they've seen this before. In the text we heard last week, Jesus feeds a great crowd in a desolate place. Does it sound familiar? And here they are in a desolate place, surrounded once again by, oh, who would have thought, a great crowd. And in Mark 6, Jesus' compassion for the crowd is what compels him to minister to them. And here, the first thing Jesus says is, I have, you guessed it, compassion on the crowd. And in that compassion, he seeks to feed them. You would think the disciples at some point would have experienced something of a theological deja vu. That they would remember how this went last time and get a little excited to be a part of it again. It's like you're the guy or gal in the room that knows how the movie ends and nobody else does. You would have thought they're just looking at these 4,000 people thinking, y'all got no idea what's coming. But they don't. Quite the opposite, actually. They, again, protest the very idea that Jesus could feed this crowd with such meager resources. They ask, how can one feed these people with just bread here in this desolate place? How can one? The same way he did the first time. By taking, blessing, breaking, and giving. That is not what's in question here. The better question is, how can these disciples not recognize what's happening? How do they not remember who they're talking to? And I got to tell you, after asking these things, I can't help but ask myself, would I have recognized the moment? Would I have recognized who I was talking to? Mark begins to answer those questions in what follows. Jesus and his disciples make way to the district of Dalmanutha and are approached by Pharisees who ask him for a sign from heaven. Signs in the Old Testament were public events that confirmed a prophecy or a claim in dispute. David Garland, a professor at Truett Seminary and one of my teachers, writes in his commentary of Mark, quote, "One sought a sign when a claimant did or said something that was strange, surprising, unconventional, or outright contrary to the Mosaic law," end quote. One example, if you need an example, is the very well-known showdown between Elijah and the prophets of Baal in 1 Kings chapter 18. The claim in question is whether or not Baal or Yahweh is the true God. So Baal's prophets and Elijah each set up their own altars and lay a bull on the wood. The gauntlet is set. Then they take turns calling upon their God, either with a lowercase g or an uppercase, your call, to, quote, answer by fire. The altar that burns will be the sign of who is telling the truth. And Elijah, the gentleman that he is, lets the prophets of Baal go first. They pray. They dance. They scream. They even cut themselves, offering drink offerings and oblations. But there was no voice, the text says. No one answered. No one paid attention. Then Elijah steps up, and in an act of what you have to call inspired hubris, he asks that a trench be dug around his altar and that it be filled with 12 jugs of water. We're getting ready to put on a show. He prays that his God, the God of Israel, answer me. And the text says, the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt offering and the wood and the stones and the dust and licked up all the water in the trench, leaving all who witnessed it proclaiming, the Lord, which is Yahweh's personal name, he is God. The Lord, he is God. This is the kind of sign the Pharisees were asking for. Something memorable. Something that makes it into the canon of Scripture. Something unforgettable. Jesus has, after all, made a pretty substantive claim to be the inaugurator of the kingdom of God. He has claimed authority to forgive sins. He has claimed lordship even of the Sabbath. What is the sign of these things, Jesus? Where's the fire from heaven? Where's the proof? Where's the proof? That seems like an honest enough request. We just want the facts, right? I care about facts, don't you? We just want the empirical evidence. In my opinion, and I like my opinions, Jesus ought to have been impressed with their quest for the truth. Well, he isn't. He isn't in the least bit. In fact, it frustrates him. Mark writes, he sighed deeply in his spirit. You know what I'm talking about. Why? Because it's unrealistic to want snow crabs and swordfish for every meal. And a faith that needs the sky to open up in order to believe is not a faith at all. And besides, who said the signs had to be fire from heaven? If you want to jump back to 1 Kings with me, a strong wind tore the mountains, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. There it is. There's the fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of a still, small voice. A thin silence, some translations say. And that is where Elijah encountered the Lord. Be careful. Always look into the sky for a sign of God's presence. You just might miss him whispering right under your nose. This is what Jesus means, I think, when he warns the disciples to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod. Leaven is a common biblical metaphor for corruption. It's not a good thing for you bread lovers out there. It is a bad thing. For dangerous influences that expand into all facets of our lives, Jesus is warning against a corrupting influence. Why the warning? What's Jesus worried about? What's he fear for the faiths and the imaginations of his disciples? The same thing that so frustrated him with the Pharisees, a spirituality that is always, and for some of you, only looking for the grand and triumphalistic signs. A faith governed by feelings, a perception of life with Christ that is always looking for emotional highs and showers of tears and ecstasy. A life of looking for the fire while turning a deaf ear to the still small voice, of always needing to be amazed and astonished, even terrified, just as long as I can feel something. A life that is discontent and indeed fearful of simplicity and normalcy. Could that be you? Is your faith governed, ruled by your emotions? Do you find yourself bored with the weekend, week out rhythm of life with Christ, hoping, praying even, that Christ would give you some big sign that any of this matters? Lord, just give me a sign. Jesus' concern for his disciples ends up proving true and well warranted. There's a delicious irony in this exchange, really. The same disciples who in Mark's gospel have witnessed Jesus turn scraps into a feast, not once, but twice they've seen it, are now fussing about the fact that they have no bread. They are on a boat with the bread of life and are completely ignorant to his gracious provision. What's the deal? Jesus asks, having eyes, do you not see? And having ears, do you not hear? And do you not remember? Do you not remember? Well, remember what? What's Jesus going to bring up if he's trying to give his disciples a crash course on his identity, his provision, or his presence? What would he ask his disciples to remember? He's got a lot to choose from, Lord knows. Do you not remember the exorcisms I performed, the unclean spirits I cast out? Well, no, that's not what he says. Do you not remember that time I told that paralytic to rise, take up his bed, and go home in front of all the religious authorities? No, that's not what he says either. Do you remember when I walked on literal water to meet you? No, not that either. Jesus asks, do you remember when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000? How many baskets full of broken pieces did you take up? And then he does the same for the 7 loaves and the 4,000. He recalls to their minds his least miraculous miracle, his most simple sign. And he apparently believes that if he had never exorcised one demon, if he had never healed one paralytic, those desert feedings would nevertheless explain everything the disciples needed to know about him. Because life with Jesus is not one of miracles and mountaintops and marvels, but of glad acceptance of Christ's simple provision, a grateful reception, a childlike gratitude for our daily bread that he gives us this day. Scoobies and swordfish are a rare delicacy. They are meals that I will always remember, but they do not hold a candle to the endless bottles of milk, bowls of cereal, PB&Js, spaghettis, and turkey sandwiches that have nourished me in infancy, went with me to elementary school, saved me money in college, and still make for a pretty good lunch today. Unforgettable, unmistakable spiritual experiences are wonderful. I've got a story or two. I'm sure some of you do too. But if you don't, and some of us are very insecure about this, that's all right, because such stories have no say in the new small mercies that we see morning by morning in Christ. Our culture, with its intoxication for glamour and glory, tempts us to crave, to desire, to even waste prayers on visible, temporal, triumphant realities. To demand signs of heaven from him. But Jesus takes bread, and he gives thanks, and he breaks it, and he gives it to us to eat to our soul's satisfaction. This is the shape of the supper, present once again in a feeding miracle of Jesus, which has been the concentration of this series so far. And it's fitting, really, to be talking about Holy Communion on a topic like this, because communion, or the Eucharist, or the Lord's Supper, whatever you'd like to call it, is the most significant, simple sign that Jesus gives us. There's nothing glamorous about it. There's nothing extravagant about it. A stale wafer and a sip of grape juice. And yet every month, at least in this church, some do it more than that. Just ask Beth Lilly back there. Probably a once a weeker. Every month for us, Jesus sits us down to receive this meal, to minister to us and our needs with this sign. We ask Jesus, Lord, show me a sign that you love me. Where's the proof that you care, that you've not forsaken me? And he says, do you not remember? This is my body, broken for you. And we ask, pray, Lord, show me I can change. Show me I'm forgiven. Show me I'm not the sum of my past mistakes. Show me there's new life in you. And Jesus looks upon each of us with that trademarked compassion of his, and he says, do you not remember? Have you forgotten already? This is my blood shed for you. Warren continues in her book, Liturgy of the Ordinary, quote, there are indeed moments of spiritual ecstasy in the Christian life and in gathered worship, Sometimes it happens here. Sometimes it's not just your experience, it's our experience. These are powerful spiritual experiences, and when they come as a gift. But they cannot be the point of Christian spirituality any more than the unforgettable pappardelle pasta dish I ate years ago in Boston's North End is the point of eating. Word and sacrament, and by sacrament she means the Lord's Supper, sustain my life. And yet they often do not seem life-changing. Quietly, even forgettably, they feed me.